Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. Do you use Zoom? You got a Zoom account? Worried about the recent security issues that are being reported? Stick around, I'm going to tell you what you need to know, and at the end of the video we're going to go through your settings and I'm going to show you which settings to change to ensure your privacy. Let's do this. Okay, yeah, welcome back. If this is your first time, please hit the subscribe button. But what we're going to talk about today is the security issues with Zoom. Forgive the COVID haircut. I'm sure there's much worse out there. We'll get through this. Zoom, what's this all about? I'm sure you've been seeing reports online in the newspapers about the security issues that Zoom are at. I actually feel sorry for them. They've been a victim of their own success. Up until the end of last year, they had 10 million users, around about that figure. This week, they are up to around 300 million daily users. So you can see how that's grown and you can see where the issues are coming from. That's what they've been. They've been a victim to their own success and they just cannot keep up with demand. And with success comes the dodgy people, i.e. hackers. There are already many Zoom URLs being registered, fake websites that look like the Zoom websites. Them are how they steal your credentials. Emails that look like they come from Zoom, they are how they steal your credentials. That's how you get hacked, that's how accounts are getting hacked, and that's how accounts are getting sold on. You could say Zoom's not at fault for that, but what they have done is they've addressed their settings. And a lot of settings now are set as default. These flaws have also brought out a new term, Zoombombing. This is where people get hold of your information, your meeting information, and join your meeting uninvited. And what they do in there, well, it's not for YouTube, but they show stuff that shouldn't be shown, most of it illegal. Again, this has been addressed in ways where you can change your settings so this can't happen. We'll go through that in a bit. The reality is with all this is it's kind of user error. There's the settings that have not been set correctly, and there's phishing emails, which is how the accounts have been hacked. So it's up to us as users to make sure the security settings are set correctly and our personal security with emails and passwords and everything that we keep on are kept to ourselves. Now Zoom have addressed this. What they've made is settings within the platform and the app itself easy to get to. They've changed some so they're now default setting. So you have to turn security settings off essentially without it being safe. And that's the fault of today's society. Today's society wants everything quick, and that's how Zoom has grown. Very easy to get on there, and it's very easy to set up, and it's very easy to use. There are wider implications for the security settings, but these are mainly for the big corporations. When you're talking about government data, real personal data, I'm talking doctor's consultations and that sort of stuff. One of the biggest concerns was how data was being routed. More often than not, it was automatically routed through the right destination, which is a server close to you. But sometimes it was being routed through China, which is not great considering China's internet privacy laws. However, that's been changed now, and you now have to opt in to allow your data to be routed through China. Why you would, I don't know, but that's been changed. There probably is some level of concern there. There's no end-to-end encryption. They have gone from AES 128-bit encryption up to 256, which is a step in the right direction, but they still need to do more. But for the average user, especially now in this climate that we're in, I'd say a lot of people are just using it just to keep in touch with friends and family, quizzes, maybe do some exercising, you know, online exercises, that sort of stuff. And for that, it really is a platform that you don't have to be worried about. We're going to go through some settings later on, and I'll show you how easy it is to carry on using Zoom, and it'll only get better. I think they've addressed things quite quickly, considering the size of what they've grown. I think they've got to be commended for that. There's still some way to go when we're talking about top-level encryption and being used at government, military, that sort of level. But I think it'll come. So in my view, unless you're passing sensitive information, government, military, personal, health details, very sensitive information, and Zoom is perfectly fine so long as the settings are correct and you look after yourself with regards to your personal security and your online security. What Zoom did is announce a 90-day plan to proactively identify, address, and enhance the security and privacy capabilities of the Zoom platform. They hit that 90 days last week with the release of Zoom 5 with a host of security enhancements. Again, we'll go into them in more detail later on with the settings. They did involve the upgrade to AES 256 encryption. So with all that in mind, let's get into it. Let's change those settings and let's carry on. Number one. The security icon. Security icon is new. A lot of the security settings were already there, but they were hidden down in the settings. So what Zoom have done now is, apart from make a lot of security settings by default already on, they've made a security tab within the meeting itself. So the security settings can be changed during the meeting. Simple to use. Once you're in the room, go down to the bottom, there's a security tab, click on that and you'll see some of the security settings you can change. One of the biggest things you need to do is password protect your meetings. That can be done in various places within the Zoom. When you set up your meetings, it's in the meeting settings. It's in your default settings. If you go there, you can see where you set the password. I recommend you always use a randomly generated password. If you have more than one meeting and you set the same password for each meeting, it means if one gets compromised, all your meetings are compromised. If you've got a randomly generated one, if someone gets hold of that one password, other meetings are still secure. Number three, allow users to join before the host. Turn that off. What this will prevent is if someone does get hold of the meeting, they can get into your meeting before you turn up there and all havoc could break loose. Turn it off, get there in time, make sure you're the first so you can vet everybody that comes into that meeting. Number four, lock the meeting. On the security tab in the meeting, if you click on that, there is an option to lock the meeting. What this will do is it will lock it down so nobody else can join. People can still leave. However, if you're expecting six participants in your meeting, lock the meeting once all six are there and no one further can join, no matter even if they've got the password. Number five, turn off participant screen share. No one wants to see some inappropriate images from participants that you don't know. If you turn this setting off, only you can share your screen. Should you need to allow someone to share the screen, you can do that on an individual basis in the settings of the meeting. Number six, use a randomly generated meeting ID. Never use, if you can, your personal ID for meetings. So if someone gets hold of this personal ID, they can get into any meeting that you use that for. And it goes without saying, never share your personal ID with anyone. Number seven, use waiting rooms. Waiting rooms allow you to vet those who are joining the meeting before you let them into the main room. This can be set as default in your settings. It can be set in the actual schedule in a meeting settings, and it also allows you to turn it on within the security tab of the meeting itself. The next one, only authenticated users can join the meeting. This means two things. If someone tries to join the meeting, they are not signed into the Zoom platform, it will tell them they need to do that. And two, there is another setting, which I suppose goes into the higher level of corporate meetings, is you can actually have the setting so that only users with a certain email domain can join a meeting. That needs to be set in the settings, but for friends and family, that won't matter as long as the user is signed in to Zoom. Next one, avoid file sharing. This goes without saying, if you don't know everybody in that room, the potential to share some malicious material is quite evident. Turn it off as default and just ask everybody to use the trusted file share sites such as Google Drive or Dropbox. Next one, remove nuisance attendees. If someone is causing you some pain, not only can you report them, you can also remove them from your meeting. If you go onto the participants tab, hover over name, click more, and you can remove them. However, one thing to remember about this is if you go into your settings before the meeting, change the setting which doesn't allow them to rejoin the meeting. And lastly, always check for updates. In the web client, if you click on your picture, another menu will come up and you'll have the option to check for updates. This will want to check and make sure there's any updates coming out. And the way Zoom are pushing out updates lately, I'd probably keep an eye on that daily. So there you have it. There's your security settings. If you have them set, you'll be good to go. If it's just friends and family, feel free to relax them so long as you trust the people that are in that room. I'm in no way associated with Zoom. I only started using it once the lockdown has started to keep in touch with friends and family, but I think it's a fantastic app. There are others out there. I've got no preference, but it's ease of use, quick to set up. 100 people on a free tier without having to pay has made it what it is today. Thanks for watching, guys. Question for today. If you're not using Zoom, if you've took advice and not used Zoom, what are you using instead? Do you think Zoom's the best platform? What would you recommend? Let me know in the comments. If this is your first time visiting, please subscribe, please give it a like, and please hit that bell icon to be notified when I release another video. These are going to be coming thick and fast. I'm going to pick up the pace a little bit for the next one, a little less glum. I'm going to show you how to run an interactive quiz on Zoom. No pen and paper needed. Should be a really fun video. Got other stuff planned, how to use a second camera. If you're new to Zoom and want to set up an account, link to a video up there. Have a look at that. Set up, ready to go. With what you just learned in this video, you'll be safe online. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. I'll see you next time. Goodbye.